Thank you so much. Thank you everybody for your kind attention. Namaste everybody. Thank you so much for joining us in this beautiful evening. Greetings. I, Randhir Kumar Gautam, on behalf of School of Humanities and Social Sciences of Raffles University, Swadhyaya Sahachkara, Circle for Creative Co-Learning, Vishwaneedam Center for Asian Blossoming, Puducherry and Chennai, and Rage Global Foundation, I welcome you to this international dialogue on the very topic, contemporary Russia. It's a great pleasure and indeed an honor to have available to us distinguished speaker, Dr. Arnab Roy Chowdhury. Thank you so much, sir, for your auspicious presence here. I would like to extend a very warm welcome to our chief patron, Honorable Justice Dr. Meena V. Gomber, former Chief Justice of Rajasthan High Court, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Raffles University, Dr. Divakar Goli, sir, Deepika Dave, Chief of Rage Global Foundation USA, discussants of today's webinar, Nina Goncharova, a very famous poet and educationist from Siberia, Professor Meera Chakravarti, Professor Anand Kumar Giri, Professor at Madras Institute of Developmental Studies and Honorary Executive of Vishwaneedam Center for Asian Blossoming, and all respected participants and students. Let me give a brief introduction to our honorary speaker. Dr. Arnab Roy Chowdhury is an assistant professor at Department of Sociology, Higher School of Economics, Moscow. He worked on the issue of forced migration of Rohingya from Myanmar and the resultant refugee crisis in South and Southeast Asia. He taught sociology to graduate business students as visiting assistant professor at IIM Kolkata. Dr. Arnab Roy received his PhD in sociology from the National University of Singapore and his MA and MPhil degrees in sociology from Sambalpur University, India. He has written so many articles for very various national and international magazines. He has some great awards also. He received award in International Sociological Association in 18th World Congress of Sociology in Yokohama, Japan. And he was conferred with Best Graduate Student Paper Award also. Beside his sound educational profession, he is a trained painter. He has published poetry also and has an interest in collecting colonial India artifacts. We are very, very grateful that he accepted our invitation to share some of his wisdom, insights on contemporary Russia. I also want to give a brief introduction to our Swadhyaya Sahachkara, Circle for Co-Learning of Self and Mutual Studies. It is an initiative of studying and learning together self, culture, and societies of the world. Friends associated with this are eager to walk and mediate with new horizons of thinking and new movements of social and cultural change at work in our contemporary world. We study seekers of Sri Aurobindo, Mahatma Gandhi, Chittaranjan Das, a seeker and creative thinker from Orissa, and many others from around the world. We present our own writings and reflect upon our creativity together. We also invite seekers from different fields of life to share with us their visions, sadhana, and a struggle for creating a world of beauty, dignity, and dialogues. We meet every Sunday or sometimes on Wednesday. We are now nurturing this in collaboration with Department of Humanities and Social Science of Raffles University and Raise Global Foundation USA. So far as the topic is concerned, today is a very important topic it is said Russia is not the East, not the West. Russia is Russia. And Russia is located between Catholic West and non-Christian East. It is a historic mission to lead the way of human society unification, as stated by Solovsko. This country has made many cultural and humanitarian contributions to the world. And in today's context, if we understand Russia, some of the main topic that would be concerned, like cyber hacking, invading Ukraine, Crimea, supporting Syria and Iran, etc. Partially the Russian state and partly the separatist. This is somewhat like Republicans in United States who have one foot in the government and other in the party of liberating ideology. As in United States, the violating businessman, for example, mafia, have pulled up into the higher tier of finance and willing dealings. But shooting down passenger jets and supplying arms to Assad is going too far. Russia has graduated to cyber manipulating entire governments, entering European Union, the Middle East, and the US. The Russian separatist problem hits the US last month with the ransomware fiasco. But the issue is whether it's Putin or someone else. In this context, now I would like to invite Professor Anant Kumar Giri, sir, to kindly moderate the session. Sir, kindly unmute yourself. Yes.
So thank you, Randhir. Namaskar, and a warm welcome to Arnab and all friends. So Arnab studied, among other places, in Sambalpur University. So, and now, of course, he speaks not only Sambalpuri, but Russian. He is now is very important and creative new university in Moscow, HSE. We are going to hear from Arnab about living in contemporary Russia, because as Randhir said, that we have we hear a lot about Russia, and something is true and something maybe it requires further realization. Some things are strikes us. For example, how do we live in a society where it seems that there is kind of authoritarianism, and the way the presidential system works and the judiciary, for example. And in this context, how do people live the sense of freedom, sense of dignity, as we live in contemporary India? You know, India is supposedly a democracy, but many of us know that, you know, if we say something, even if we say something, it can be manipulated to such an extent that tomorrow we find ourselves in our mother's brothers. You know, in Odia we have a very interesting theme called Mamu Ghara, means, you know, we lend ourselves, you know, in the place of the prison system. So, but with and beyond geopolitical reality and perceptions, the challenge for us is to understand how a contemporary society and state functions and how people, ordinary people, you and me, especially academics, how they function. As we are opening ourselves to learning and listening about contemporary Russia, and listening is very important because listening calls for us to suspend our many a priori judgments. And we also remember the great stream of Russian influence in India and the world. We remember Tolstoy and the way Tolstoy influenced Gandhi. Many of us have read Maxim Gorky's The Mother, and also Boris Pasternak. You know, the kind of struggle for freedom that Pasternak embodied. And I was reading a little bit about it, and I was reading that Pasternak was born into a very creative family. I think his mother was a composer, and of course that tradition of Russia, beautiful music, composition, songs, and literature, and that is the spiritual dimension of Russia, which resonates very much with India. But at the same time, the political organization of society has always faced a lot of challenge. But how is that? You know, of course, we before the Russian Revolution, there was the Tsarist system, and which was so authoritarian. And then after the Bolshevik Revolution, then came the Bolshevik Party, and then after Lenin came Stalin, and with all these from 1917 to 1991. And after that, what do we get? And the whole Yeltsin regime and the destruction of the economy and the coming of Putin. And then, so it is that kind of a political organization of society. It is against that background. How can we understand this one like Boris Pasternak, who almost 60 years ago or 70, 80 years ago could imagine a different reality? And the story goes that when he was growing up as a small child, Leo Tolstoy was visiting him, and his mother had organized a special, you know, a special musical offering to Leo Tolstoy, which had a very important influence on Boris Pasternak. So the Boris Pasternak story is that even in those days of difficulty, if Pasternak could articulate a different spirit of the soul and a different imagination, poetry, literature in contemporary Russia, and we are very grateful to Nina. And Nina is a deep spiritual soul and a spiritual co-worker of humanity. And Nina's work, she is born in Russia, and she is also a kind of a daughter of the Mother Earth. You know, we have heard her a few months ago in our Sahachakra dialogue, and some of us take part in the very important work that she does. And when we listen to friends like Nina, we get a glimpse of that kind of the earth work. You know, that kind of the work of the humanity, the dreaming about a different art that is being done in contemporary Russia. What we call as cosmopolitanism, we mainly associate with the known regions of cosmopolitanism, like in modern Europe, Immanuel Kant and then Habermas. And so they are our visions of the world that comes from a particular corner of the world. Similarly, we need to understand what are some of the creative thinkers and people in Russia, what is their vision of not only Russia, but a different world. And when we listen to Nina, we get a glimpse of that. With this very preliminary offering, so I invite, and we are very happy to have Arnab with us. And Arnab will share with us about this theme of living in contemporary Russia for around 30 to 35 minutes and initially, and then after that we listen to Nina, and then we would listen to each other. Today we would bring our dialogue to 5:30, as Randhir was mentioning, that our friends are also nurturing this very important World Poetry Conference beginning at 5:30. So today we will go up to 5:30 please. So Arnab.
Thank you so much, Professor Ananta Giri. Thank you, Randhir, Professor Randhir, for introducing, for giving such a nice introduction. And thanks to Professor Meera Chakravarti and Nina, Professor Nina Goncharova, for coming and joining and hosting this talk and dialogue with us. I'm audible clearly?
Yes.
Okay. So, you know, if pardon me if there is some internet problem, because sometimes it occurs, and you know, and then I have to reconnect in that case, but that should not be a problem. But it, normally it doesn't occur, but sometimes it does. So thanks to you all for having me here today. But I would start with a disclaimer, and that is I'm in no way an expert on contemporary Russia or contemporary Russian life. So I believe Professor Nina Goncharova is here, and she's an expert on Russia. She's a Russian, and she's an expert on Russian history, Russian art, aesthetics, and, you know, of course, Russian life, way of life. However, what I'm going to share with you today is that, you know, how is my life, you know, how is my life in Russia, right? So how I feel about Russia, how I came here, how I feel about its society, culture, politics, art, aesthetics, social life, sociality in general. So I will talk about that. And therefore, I mean, because it largely is kind of my own experience, I did not really prepare any slide or presentation for this. So I thought I can speak about my life in Russia for about 35 minutes, which is fine. And it would have various interesting aspects, I believe, because Russian society is indeed very interesting and indeed something which I would not have known even a bit if I had not come to Russia. So, you know, so this is something exclusive in that sense, that you come here and you see the society, you feel the society, you stay there for long, you interact with the wonderful and nice people around you, you interact with the university, professors, colleagues, students, and of course, you interact with the common people on the streets, on the mall, and everywhere. I'm a sociologist, so I do that usually. So let me start from, you know, from the beginning of the journey to Russia. So I came in Russia in 2017, in the month of August. So before that, I was in India. I was located in Kolkata. And I was teaching as an assistant professor in Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta. So at one point of time, when I was teaching there, so I finished my PhD in Singapore. I came back to India. My family stays there, mainly my mom, my brother, and his wife. So as I started staying there, it was a bit of difficulty for me, you know, after having stayed in Singapore for 7 years, to suddenly kind of adjust with the life, the social life, and of, you know, the kind of education that I was teaching was excellent. IIM Calcutta is excellent, but still I had some problem with conducting research and other things, because I'm mainly a person, as Randhir said, that, you know, I am mainly a person who is more interested in research. So I do a lot of research. I mobilize funds from different places to do field work activities. So I'm very much connected with the field. So I regularly do field works, I write, etc. So being an institution which is largely focused on teaching business students, I was, you know, feeling slightly alienated, because I'm a sociologist, you know, and I had to teach a certain kind of sociology there, which is more oriented towards market, business, and other things, which is not my forte. Usually that's not what I do. So as I was kind of teaching there, I was searching for different positions throughout the world. I was applying. Academic life is full of rejections, as you know. Despite having good number of publications and other things, I was being rejected right and left from all other, from all institutions throughout the world. So, and then I kind of, as I searched through the internet, I found this very interesting place which had their advertisement for recruiting postdocs. It is called Higher School of Economics. Now, Higher School of Economics is a relatively new university. In Russian, it is known as Vishya Skola Ekonomiki. So now, but the Higher School of Economics kind of institutions or universities are actually quite prevalent, even, you know, in post-Soviet Russia. So it has a legacy in Russian education system. Though this particular Higher School of Economics in Moscow was opened only around in 1990s after its liberalization or opening up after the fall of the Soviet Union and, you know, Russia liberalized, and then an institution like Higher School of Economics is opened here. And it was opened with the, you know, it was established with the help of London School of Economics and Political Science. So I saw this advertisement, I got very interested, I applied, and luckily, you know, they called me for interview, my interview was good, and I was selected. So it was in 2017, August, I arrived in Moscow. Arriving in Moscow, you know, is a slightly, it was initially slightly difficult journey, because most of the documents that I received from university, the visa center and other places were mostly in Russian. So I kind of translated them into English. And then I had the feel that, you know, probably to be in Russia or to teach in Russia and kind of live my life here for a vibrant social life in Moscow and Russia, probably I would need to learn a bit of Russian. And that anybody who wants to come to Russia or who wants to stay in Russia should know that apart from the university, which speaks English, you know, all my colleagues and students speak English very well, and administrators also speak English very well, but outside the university, for managing your day-to-day life, you need a bit of Russian language knowledge. Initially, of course, I had no knowledge of Russian language, and then I downloaded some particular app. There's a prevalent app, so nobody uses. So Russia is another world, by the way. You know, it's a world which has its own means. It has its own platforms. It has its own social media. Everything is kind of highly nationalized and, you know, regionalized and, you know, and nativized with the help of Russian language. So Russia has its own social media platform, which is similar like Facebook, but they call it VKontakte, which is very similar in many of its appearances, but also different. And then they have their own apps. Unlike Google, they have Yandex app through which you can search. And then Yandex have excellent, you know, maps, much better than Google actually for Russia. So mostly people use Yandex maps. And then I use Yandex translating apps. I downloaded that. Then Yandex have excellent, you know, apps on metro connectivity and bus connectivity. So this is one of the best apps actually I have ever seen throughout the world. So, you know, when Randhir was talking about IT, yes, IT is actually quite robustly developed, but, you know, it's another issue that sociologically, if we do a comparison of IT industries and entrepreneurs in Russia with that of India, that would be very interesting. One of my good friend, a Russian person, Artem Uldanov. So Artem and me both are actually planning to do a project, to do some research on, you know, sociological dimension of information technology and entrepreneurship in Russia and India. And that has very many interesting economic sociological aspects, and we can discuss that later. So as I came to Russia and as I came to Moscow, so Russia is very big. I should not talk about Russia actually. I should talk about Moscow and few places that I've visited. So as I came to Moscow and to my university, Higher School of Economics, which is located at the very center of the city, near Kremlin. Opposite to the university is the Bolshoi Theater, which is kind of the historically famous Bolshoi Theater, the big theater where, you know, all the most famous theaters and ballet dance have been performed there for the last more than 50 years or 60 years and more during Soviet Russia as well. So it is very famous place. And so this is an extremely beautiful and picturesque space architecturally, spatially, and the kind of motifs and symbols, the kind of wall paintings and et cetera. And just you walk 15 minutes and you reach the Kremlin, which is a historical site. And you see the most, so the most important and most interesting part of Moscow is there, but then Moscow is a very big city. And it has many, many, you know, many interesting parts. It has more than 100 museums located in various localities. And it is a historic city with more than 800 years of history, continuous history. So it has a long history, but more than 800 years of continuous history. So that makes Moscow as a city extremely interesting. As I came to Russia, I found my first day was very interesting. I found that I cannot actually communicate with most of the people. But what I found is more interesting is that most of the people were extremely, they went out of their way to help me. So I was not able to find my address. It was written somewhere, but you know, I was moving around the city with a taxi driver. He was very kind. And I went, when I came to the, you know, near about the place where I am going to stay as a postdoc student, the dormitory with a single, you know, single room apartment that was allotted to me. I came near to that place, but I was not able to find the place. And a passerby actually took my luggage, crossed the road, called the taxi, put me inside, and then asked the taxi to, you know, take me to the exact place. So, you know, unlike many other people who told me that, you know, in Russia, when you walk on the street, people don't smile at each other. You know, they are very, they can be very somber. You know, it's not that they don't want to talk, or it's not that they don't, are not friendly, but it's simply that they don't smile at each other. And I found that later, why they don't smile at each other, somebody told me. So, but I found them extremely helpful. So they actually put all my luggage in the, you know, taxi cab that I had, and then I reached my place. This was an old, beautiful Soviet era building, which has been converted to a hostel. So previously it was a flat, but now the university has bought that building and it has been converted to a hostel. The university has such so many hostels. And what I found that the students who stay there, they stay in those hostels, beautiful hostels, fairly good with canteens and, you know, where you can pay and have food. There's place and kitchen, everything where you can cook. But I found that actually they stay for very cheap. And that kind of, you know, that kind of fees is not even expected in India. I found the students stay there for about 1,000 to 1,200 rupees, which is basically same as ruble almost now. And that was, so I found that the student and their staying and their life and somehow the university and the state have been able to, you know, control in a such a manner that it is habitable, inhabitable for students. They can stay fairly with cheap expenses. They can eat with cheap expenses because there are canteens where you can show your student cards and then you can eat with a subsidized price. So I kind of started feeling good, but at the same time, I was not able to talk much. So I used to use Yandex app and translate and show to people. And they were very fairly nice. What I found another interesting, very interesting thing in Moscow is that once you are out on the street, there are a number of supermarkets. So people who stayed in Russia or Moscow in 1990s, beginning of 1990s, they would not imagine this. Whoever told me about Moscow and Russia about this time, they found actually there was a very lack of choice in the market, right? So one of the market dimension of Soviet state was that so the commodities and commodity prices were regulated. Now, of course, after 1990s opening up slowly in another 10 years, we see emerging large number of market chains and supermarket chains, but these are Russian supermarket chains. These are not American brands or American supermarket chains or even European supermarket chains. So the food and things you get here are of immense variety, but at the same time, if you want, you can actually buy very many good things for really not that much expensive prices that you know sometimes pay for these things in Europe or America. So you have a choice. Of course, there are many things that you want to buy in commodity from these supermarkets, which can be very expensive, luxurious items and other things. But for day-to-day life, these things, many things, you can buy for, you know, not in I should not say cheap, but inexpensive prices. So that one of the things I marked, because I have lived a life in Singapore, they have a lot of supermarket chain, but at the same time, it can be very expensive. You know, even by Singapore standards, whatever salary you get there, it can be really expensive. So as I started living my life there, in the initial days, I visited, so Russia is really big. It's really multicultural, you know? So India is big, you know, and India is multicultural, you know, but I think geographically you can fit almost six Indias within Russia, almost five or six Europe within Russia. So you can imagine how big this is. Of course, many part of the Russia might not be that inhabitable. It's cold. You know, many people don't live there. Most of the population live near the big cities, and Moscow, St. Petersburg, you know, Novosibirsk. These are one of the big, you know, cities. There are many other big cities. But at the same time, you know, you find extremely large number of ethnicities, religion, you know, whatever you say, quote unquote race. We don't use the term race. It's not really a kind of explainable term, but you can say that large number of ethnicities, cultures, linguistic variation, and religion stay here. In Russia, towards the south, on the Caucasus region, there's a large Muslim population in Kazan, in Dagestan, and in Chechnya, and in Crimea. So there's a large population of Muslims here. They're extremely nice and extremely friendly. And and in Moscow city itself, you find around 110 ethnicities. More than 110 kinds of ethnicities and languages. So, you know, as you go and see Moscow and walk around Moscow, you will find restaurants of all these different groups and ethnicity of people. They have all their own business. They have their own souks and markets and bazaars. They have their own restaurants, and they are extremely nice and extremely friendly. I have been to these places sometimes, as they know that you are from India, they will offer you free things without, you know, just for, you know, just so that you can taste it, just so that you can eat it. And it is quite, you know, I was quite amazed. Even when we didn't understand each other's language, we spoke through sign language, and slowly I learned something which was very interesting for me, that is Russian language has so many words which is exactly similar to Indian, I mean, to Bengali that I speak, to Indian language, to Hindi, or, you know, so I realized, somebody, one of my friend called Anna, she said that actually she does some research on this, and she says there are so many words, actually you don't even know, you know, I know that, she said, I know there are so many words which are exactly similar, there are so many expressions which are exactly similar. And as I started learning, and I must say my learning have been very slow, because I had, you know, I have so much work to do with teaching and research and, you know, supervision and other things in the university. But as I learned a bit of Russian for managing my day-to-day life in the market and, you know, just managing my life little, I found that actually there are so many words and so many expressions exactly similar that I get dumbstruck, that how can it happen? So, and I can give you example which are very interesting, because I found that when we do the coughing, right? Coughing, which is khasi in Hindi, and Bengali, it's kashi. So actually in Russian, it's kashi, exactly the same that we speak in Bengali, kashi, okay? So when we have bukhar, fever, in Bengali, we call it jor. In Russian, it's zar. So it's actually very similar. In, you know, in fire is ogni, which is Sanskrit is also ogni, and in Bengali, we call agun, but a large number of Russian actually call agun, because, you know, ogni is one term and agun is the fire and the light. So you have lamps, which is ogni, and then the fire there is, which is agun. So there's slight difference. So, and there are very many words, you know, simple words that we talk, even the expressions, the way it is expressed. So, you know, the grammatical structures and other things, there are so many similarities that, you know, I found it very interesting as a language. My first, so since, as I said, Russia is really big, I have no inhibitions of testing, you know, or prohibitions of testing food and other things. I went around in different cultures, in different places. I talked with them. I stayed with them. I tested their food. I enjoyed their culture, their song, and their life. Then I kind of visited some places in Russia. And these places are kind of, two are situated in the Golden Ring. There's a famous Golden Ring cities in Russia. So I visited Rostov Veliki and Yaroslavl. And these are, you know, by city size, these are smaller cities beside the river Volga, which is the historic, you know, river traversing through Russia. And I had, you know, almost spiritual experience there. So when I visited Volga, and, you know, with my friends, Russian friends and students, I was walking beside Volga in Yaroslavl. They have beautiful, Yaroslavl has one of the most beautiful Kremlin I have ever seen. It is much, you know, I must say it is much beautiful than Moscow City also, you know, in the Kremlin. I found the Kremlin much bigger, beautiful and wonderful. They have a wonderful church there, number of churches there. And Russian church has a very distinct architecture of the onion dome. So it's a church with the onion dome, which is very similar to Turkish architecture. And then I found from one of my friends that, you know, because the Russian Tsar and the Russian Tsar family has a long relation with Turkey, right? So the fall of the Byzantium, which was the Byzantium was the Orthodox center at one point of time, and then the fall of Byzantium happened, and then the Turkish dynasties, mostly Islamic dynasties, emerged. But the Russian Tsar had a very good relation with this Islamic dynasties, and much of the Russian church architecture has been actually inspired by the Turkish onion dome. So the onion dome that you see on the Russian churches are actually examples of, you know, cross-religious camaraderie, cross-cultural camaraderie, cross-cultural in exchange. And many Russian families, mostly nobilities, have married across the Tatar Muslim families, the Dagestani Muslim families, the Kazan Muslim families, the Turkish Muslim families. So many nobilities in Russia, in India we call, for example, zamindars. In Russia they call it boyars. So very big boyar families, such as of Leo Tolstoy. Leo Tolstoy was himself belonging to a family of boyars, or big king, like big zamindars, nobilities. You know, such families have relations of marriage with Turkish dynasties, Turkish kings, you know, Tartars and others. So, you know, Russia has been a place of cosmopolitanism, of cross-cultural exchange, of cross-religious exchange, of cross, in the truest possible sense, and cross-religious dialogue. It is not a kind of multiculturalism that we see in the West, you know, where we talk about multiculturalism, but where multicultural identities stay at its own place, right? It's somewhat ghettoized, you know. In Russia, these kinds of relations are not ghettoized. People actually, you know, large number of Russian, in contemporary Russia, large number of Russian men and Russian women marry across religion. And there is something very interesting, which I found out. Marrying, the rules of marriage, though Russia is an Orthodox country, though Russia, according to many other, you know, countries and places, you know, difficult rules and etc. Rules of marriage in Russia are the most easy rules in the entire world. And when I'm saying most easy rule, you know, I mean that even a refugee or any citizen from other country coming here, and where both the citizens are from different country and they're living in Russia, they can marry within a month of notice, legally. Religion doesn't matter. Citizenship doesn't matter. Ethnicity doesn't matter. Language doesn't matter. So, you know, when we want to understand Russia, or, you know, it is necessary, and I'm not a big fan of either, you know, indigenous theories or, you know, completely, you know, theories of Western origin or philosophy which are completely indigenous or philosophy of Western origin. However, I believe that each places, and a place like Russia, which is kind of taking a space which is more than, you know, seven times the entire Europe, more than seven, you know, six times India and the entire space. And, you know, so it's a corner, but the corner is bigger than the center, right? So that means you have to understand this space of Eurasia from within, you know, in some sense. And I'm not saying that you have to understand only by indigenous theories or only by, you know, Western theories. I'm saying that however you want to understand, you have to understand by feeling it, by knowing it, by staying there, and by knowing the place. So there are many, very many, which you can say that, you know, authoritarian dimensions, but this authoritarian dimension did not start now. Russia has a long history, right, of more than 800 years of Tsar and communist rule, and all these rules have its own authoritarianisms.
So now at this juncture, Arnab, I request that some of our friends like yourself, so our friends are from Odisha, and they, it helps a bit to translate it into Odia. And today we are we are so blessed that I do not have to do the translation so much. So I request you to whatever you have spoken, just a very small gist, maybe if it is not too easy, maybe one or two lines in Odia, and then I would add a few things. Mane apan jaha kahile tara Odia re dui tin ta mane
sir mui jaha kahili actually mui Odia mane mui Odia kahi paruche kintu seta Sambalpuri Odia au mui jaha kahili seta mui Odia re translate korba ta more like mane more pai little difficult kanki. These are English word which I don't even know how to translate in Bengali, you know, some of them.
Okay.
So that's why I would request you, upon ko tike request karbi moi, please, upon translate kariba, fine.
Sure. First of all, thank you, Arnab. It is really, you know, one can feel the vibrancy of the soul, the joy of the soul as you move from one country to the other, and that the whole what can be called as the whole dance of life, and Amaro, first of all, our friends, as in every session we take a little time to translate into Odia, and I am grateful to all friends for their generosity for a few minutes. Amaro bhai bhoni mane am sangre arnab achanti ଏବଂ ସେ ଏତେ ସହଜରେ କହୁଛନ୍ତି, ମୁଁ ଆଶା କରୁଛି ଆପଣମାନେ ସମସ୍ତେ ତାଙ୍କ କଥା ବୁଝିପାରୁଥିବେ। ଆଉ ତଥାପି ଏଇ ସୂତ୍ର କଥାଟିଏ ଆମର ଅର୍ଣ୍ଣବ, ଯିଏ ସମ୍ବଲପୁର ୟୁନିଭର୍ସିଟିରେ ଏମ୍ଏ କରିଛନ୍ତି ସୋସିଓଲୋଜିରେ, ତାପରେ ସିଙ୍ଗାପୁରରୁ PhD କରିଛନ୍ତି, ତାପରେ ଅଗଷ୍ଟ 2017 ମସିହାରେ ଏଇ ରଷିଆର ଏଇ ନୂଆ ୟୁନିଭର୍ସିଟି HSE ହାୟର ସ୍କୁଲ ଅଫ୍ ଇକୋନୋମିକ୍ସକୁ ଆସିଲେ, ଏବଂ ଆସିଲା ପରେ ସେ ଅନୁଭବ କଲେ ଯେ ପ୍ରକୃତରେ ଆଉ ମସ୍କୋରେ ଯେତେବେଳେ ପହଞ୍ଚିଲେ, ତାଙ୍କର ବାଟ ଖୋଜୁ ଖୋଜୁ ତାଙ୍କ ଆପାର୍ଟମେଣ୍ଟକୁ ସମସ୍ତେ କେତେ ସାହାଯ୍ୟ କଲେ, ଜଣେ ତାଙ୍କର ଜିନିଷପତ୍ର ନେଇକି ପହଞ୍ଚେଇ ଦେଲେ। ତେଣୁ ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ରଷିଆରେ ଆଉ ସବୁ ଦେଶ ଭଳି ଆମେ, ମୁଁ ବି ଯେତେବେଳେ ଚାଇନା ଯାଇଛି, ଆମେ ରଷିଆର ସମ୍ପର୍କରେ ଯେମିତି ଆମର ସବୁ ଧାରଣା ରହିଛି, ଚାଇନା ସମ୍ପର୍କରେ ସେମିତି ଅନେକ ଧାରଣା ରହିଛି, ବିଶେଷ କରି ଆମର ଜିଓ ପଲିଟିକାଲ ଡିଫିକଲ୍ଟିଜ୍। ମୁଁ ଯେତେବେଳେ ଚାଇନା ବି ଯାଇଥିଲି ସେତେବେଳେ 2004 ମସିହାରେ, ସେତେବେଳେ ମୁଁ ଯାଇଛି ସିଆନ୍, ଯେଉଁଠି ହ୍ୱାନସାଙ୍ଗ ଆସିଥିଲେ, ମୁଁ ବସ୍ ଷ୍ଟାଣ୍ଡରେ ବସିକି ପଚାରୁଛି ଏଇ ବାଟଟା ଯିବ କି ସିଟି ସେଣ୍ଟରକୁ। ସେଠି ଜଣେ ମାନେ ବସ୍ରେ ଜଣେ ଥିଲେ, ଭଉଣୀ ଜଣକ ଥିଲେ, ସେ ଖାଲି ମୋତେ ସେ ବାଟ ବତେଇ ଦେଲେନି, ସେ ମୋ ସାଙ୍ଗରେ ଓହ୍ଲେଇଲେ, ବସ୍ରୁ ଓହ୍ଲେଇଲେ, ଓହ୍ଲେଇକି ପୁରା ମ୍ୟୁଜିୟମ୍ ଦେଖେଇଲେ। ତାପରେ ୱି ହ୍ୟାଡ୍ ଲଞ୍ଚ ଟୁଗେଦର, ସେ ମୋତେ ଲଞ୍ଚ ପାଇଁ ଆମନ୍ତ୍ରଣ କରେ। ଆଉ ତାପରେ ସେଦିନ 4 ବେଳେ ମୋର ଗୋଟେ ଗାଡ଼ି ଧରିକି ଯିବାର ଥିଲା ଆଉ ଗୋଟେ ସିଟିକୁ, ସେ ମୋତେ ଟ୍ୟାକ୍ସିରେ ଆଣି ମୋର ୟୁଥ୍ ହଷ୍ଟେଲରୁ ଜିନିଷ ନେଇକି ଷ୍ଟେସନରେ ପହଞ୍ଚେଇ ଦେଲେ। ତେଣୁ ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ଜୀବନର ଅନୁଭବ, ସେଇଗୁଡ଼ାକ ଯେଉଁ ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ରଷିଆରେ ଏମିତି ହେଉଛି, ଚାଇନାରେ ଏମିତି ହେଉଛି, ନିଜେ ରହିଲେ ହିଁ ଆମେ ଅନୁଭବ କରୁ। ଯେଉଁ କଥା ଅର୍ଣ୍ଣବ କହିଲେ ଯେ ସେ ଯଦି ରଷିଆରେ ରହିନଥାନ୍ତେ, ତାହେଲେ ରଷିଆନ୍ ସମାଜ କ'ଣ ସେ ଅନୁଭବ କରିପାରିନଥାନ୍ତେ। ତା ଅର୍ଥ ହେଉଛି ଆମେ ଯଥାର୍ଥ ସମ୍ଭବ ଆମେ ଅନ୍ୟ ଦେଶକୁ ଯିବା, ରହିବା, ସେଇ ଦେଶ ସଂସ୍କୃତି ଭିତରେ କ'ଣ ସବୁ ରହିଛି, tapare au sethi moscow re au russia re bibhinna prakar au lokomane raichanti au russia re aneka jagare musliman bhai bhoni mane raichanti au samankara sanskruti ebong moscow re bi taku ethnicity boli kaha jauchi pray 110 ebong samankara nijo nijoro sob bazar raichi jemti apan jabe jauthibe au turkish bazar hoy to nischanchito au ame jete bele bi jau west ku jau I'm sure professor mira chakrabarti and many of have experienced sete sob turkish bazar thai indian bazar thai au thik semti sob bazar raichi sob au tapare je russian sampratika russia re jo prakar market supermarket mankare sete alpa bahut paisa na dei ki bi anek jinso kinibaku milibo तेणु एमती गोटे इज अफ लाइफ गोटे जीवन रोटे सहजता आसी जाए हे तो जहाँ पाखे बेस पैसा न थी भी सी बची पार्टी एमती तापर आउ गोटे कथी कौन जे रशिया जो संभ्रांत पर जो जमीदार परिमाण जहाँ को आम जमीदार कहचु नबिलिटी कहचु से मानकर आ मुसलमान आम हे तो अर्थोडक्स चर्च रशियन अर्थोडक्स चर्च गोटे प्राधान्य रही ଏବଂ ସେହି ବିଷୟରେ ପରେ ଅଧିକ କଥା ହେବା ଆଉ କାହିଁକି ବର୍ତ୍ତମାନ ପଲିଟିକାଲ ରେଜିମ୍ରେ କେତେ ଦୂର ରଷିଆନ୍ ଅର୍ଥୋଡକ୍ସ ଚର୍ଚ୍ଚ ଅଧିକ ପ୍ରାଧାନ୍ୟ ଇଜ୍ ଇଟ୍ ଏ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍ ରିଲିଜିଅନ୍ ଅର୍ ନଟ୍ ବା ସେମାନେ ଇସ୍କନ୍କୁ ଆମର ସେଠି ଯେଉଁ ଆମର ରଷିଆର ଅଧିକାଂଶ ଅନେକ ରଷିଆ ଭାଇ ଭଉଣୀମାନେ ଇସ୍କନ୍ ପ୍ରତି ଅନେକ ଆକୃଷ୍ଟ ଏବଂ ଏବଂ ସେଇଟା ବି ଆମେ ବୁଝିବା କ'ଣ ପାଇଁ ଆମର ରଷିଆର ଭାଇ ଭଉଣୀମାନେ ଇସ୍କନ୍ ପ୍ରତି ଏତେ ଆକୃଷ୍ଟ ଏବଂ ମସ୍କୋରେ ଯେଉଁ ବଡ଼ ଟେମ୍ପଲ୍ଟା ବନାଯାଉଥିଲା ଏବଂ ସେଇଟାକୁ ଷ୍ଟେଟ୍ ହୁଏତ ପରମିଟ୍ କଲାନି କିନ୍ତୁ ଜଣାପଡ଼ୁଛି ଏତେ ଆଗ୍ରହ ରହିଛି ତେଣୁ ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ରିଲିଜିୟସ୍ ଡାଇଭର୍ସିଟି ଆଉ ରଷିଆନ୍ ଅର୍ଥୋଡକ୍ସ ଚର୍ଚ୍ଚ ଏବଂ ତାପରେ ଅନ୍ୟ ପ୍ରକାର ଆଉ ତାପରେ ମୁସଲମାନ ଆଉ ରଷିଆନ୍ ଲୋକମାନଙ୍କ ଭିତରେ ବିବାହ ଚାଲିଛି ଆଉ ଏଇ ଯେଉଁ ବିବାହର ଯେଉଁ ନିୟମଟି ସେଇଟା ଭାରି ସହଜ ଏବଂ ତାର ଆଉ ଗୋଟେ କଥା ବି ହେଇପାରିବ ଯେ ବିବାହର ନିୟମ ଯେତିକି ସହଜ ଆଉ ଡାଇଭର୍ସର ନିୟମ ସେତିକି ସହଜ କି ଆଉ ଏ ବିଷୟରେ ହେଇପାରିବା ଆଉ ପୁଣି ଏତିକି ସଂକ୍ଷେପରେ ଆଉ ଆପଣମାନେ ଯଦି ବୁଝିପାରୁଛନ୍ତି ଆମର ଅର୍ଣ୍ଣବ ଭାଇଙ୍କ କଥା ତେଣୁ ମୁଁ ସଂକ୍ଷେପରେ କହିଦେଉଛି ଆପଣ ଖାଲି ଟିକେ ସୂତ୍ର ଧରିଦେବେ ସୋ ଏବେ ନା ଅର୍ଣ୍ଣବ ପ୍ଲିଜ୍
Sir, how much time do I have is so that I can, you know, keep it brief?
Sure. No, how much time you would like to take, please?
No, I have no problem. I can talk go on. But I just...
Another 15 minutes.
15 minutes? Okay, sure. Okay. Oh, thank you. So I was talking about the wonderful experience that I had in Rostov Veliki, which is a golden ring city beside River Volga and Yaroslavl, which is another golden ring city, very close to each other. So there is a golden, there are about five cities around the River Volga in the, you know, center part of Russia, which connects with each other, which has long history of Orthodox Church and Christianity. And they have beautiful churches and other kind of motifs where you can see museums, which you can see, and which depicts kind of historical Russia, right? The way it has developed, the way it has, you know, evolved over the years, more than 800 years. So as I visited Yaroslavl, I was walking beside River Volga, and then with my friends and my students, and I found that a person who was singing Russian song, of course, I didn't understand, you know, each of the words that was there in the song, but he was singing Russian song, but in the style of R.D. Burman. So he was singing Russian song with, you know, changing his voice, modulating in his voice like R.D. Burman and with, you know, particular style. And he was a fantastic singer. So we stayed there for some time. We listened to his song. We talked to him. And we found that actually he is so much inspired by Indian movies, Indian films, and he even knows R.D. Burman. So the, you know, that was something. I thought that he's kind of modulating his voice like R.D. Burman, but I thought maybe it's Russian style, right? So maybe he's singing in his own style. And then when I found that actually he's inspired by not only Russian style of singing, which is with voice modulation, you can sing, even it is used in Russian movies, that kind of singing, but he's actually inspired by Hindi movies, you know, Indian style of singing, and he knows a lot about Indian music. Of course, I had no idea. He was a teacher, so I learned from him about Indian music and many other things. Then I visited the city called Rostov Veliki. It was a small city, and you must know that actually in Russia, what has happened over years, particularly after liberalization, a large number of population from the rural and the hinterland region of Russia, because of lack of, you know, industrial development in those places, have moved to big cities like Moscow. So a large number of population from Rostov Veliki has actually moved out to St. Petersburg and Moscow. So most of the cities, if you visit in the rural areas or away from Moscow, not so rural area, but kind of semi-urban areas, you will find a large number of older population living there. And they are mostly doing business, you know, with the tourists. They have beautiful, many of them have restaurants, many of this older population, they maintain, you know, guest houses where you can stay. And these are not expensive at all. And so you feel like you're, you know, staying at home. So you, and they're extremely nice people. We call in Russia, you know, older women are called babushka. So it's like, you know, in fact, it has a similar word in Bengali. We call boyoshka. Boyoshka, I think in Oriya also it's similar. Boyoshka is an older woman. So, you know, babushka is a general term for older women. We like dadi, we call, you know, when we go to villages, we meet dadis, right? Our village dadis and dadajis. And, you know, so you find them and they're extremely loving. They're extremely caring. And you kind of interact with them. They talk about Russian life. They talk about their children, how they have moved to Moscow. They miss them so much, right? So once in a while they visit them. So in Russia, there is another interesting culture. And this is the culture of dacha. Dacha is kind of, is the village home. You know, the dacha is the village home, the summer cottage. So when you are working, you're working in the city. So and that emerged, you know, the concept of dacha was always there, but dacha is loved more now because of this migrant population, right? So population, large number of people from villages, hinterlands and other places, they're highly skilled, they're very smart. They're coming to the city like Moscow, they're offering their services, the labors, they're you know, working in all kinds of places from the industries to the hotels and smaller places. Now these people, when they get a weekend or longer weekend, they yearn for their villages. They yearn for their babushkas, they yearn for their, you know, dadajis and dadis. So they return back to the village for a short while, for 5 days. And in villages, you see a growth of also dachas, which are being made by these people by spending some money. So village cottage, which are beautiful to stay, and which is a kind of space of relaxation. So space of relaxation, largely beside rivers, beside forests. And there's a big culture in Russia of mushroom picking and berry picking. So young guys, even young people, they love picking of mushrooms. So they learn this art from their babushkas, from their dadajis, from their father, right? From their dadis, they go with them, they take care of them, they go with them in the forest, they pick berries and mushrooms and have picnics and cook these in their dachas, right? So this is a kind of, you know, this is a kind of urban, rural or rurban, you know, connection that you find in the society, very strong, which is very strong, you know? So the rural-urban connection is very strong. It remains very strong. So dadajis and dadis and babushkas, they come and make beautiful varenye. So varenye is a jam. It's a jam, but not really a jam. So you basically, it's like murabba. Varenye is murabba, basically. So you basically have, you know, different kind of fruits which are boiled and then they put in the, you know, syrup, and the extract of the fruits are made into small, you know, kept into small bottles for long, so that when they're, you know, potas and potis come home, they can taste their babushkas varenye, right? For which they have made, like we make achar in home. So you find many similarities, right, across cultures. And this is not only about Russia. If you go in another place, many other countries, you can find such homologies or such similarities, cultural translations, which you can easily do. And believe me, for these cultural translation and to relate it to one of the very interesting texts, Habitations of Modernity by Dipesh Chakraborty. And Dipesh Chakraborty is a postcolonial scholar. He's saying that this kind of cultural translations don't need any academic theoretician. You don't have to be a sociologist or academics. You can perfectly be a normal person with no relation to sociology or social science, and still you can make that academic, you know, not academic, but cultural translation so easily. And he gives example of Uzbekistan or some other countries where the children, how they see Ramayan in TV, and then they actually start playing Ramayan in their own context. Somebody becomes Ram, somebody becomes Ravan, and they start playing. So people translate those things across culture, across religion. Nobody needs, actually, you know, common people don't need religion to translate culture or culture each other. They can just observe each other, talk to each other. So this is a kind of more bottom-up translation, which does not need to be mediated by any religious text, any state or anybody else, or even any academic text, or even it does not need to be mediated by Dipesh Chakraborty also. I just gave example. People just can understand each other if you give them space, and if they can, you know, talk to each other, they can make cultural bridges, cultural homologies with each other. It's very easy. It's very, you know, as long as you're sympathetic to the other person, as long as you have empathy, you can understand that what kind of problems others are facing. You can help your lending hand. And believe me, nobody will see what religion, what culture, what skin color, what ethnicity you belong to. People in general are very loving to each other. They can accept anybody as long as you are empathetic and loving. And this was my kind of experience. Probably I have another 2-3 minutes. And I will also talk slightly about the education system, which is very interesting. It is becoming more and more cosmopolitan and contemporary education system here. We have large number of English speaking programs now at HSE, master's program and PhD programs. Many of them are English speaking. In master's program, the fees is very less. So you can get a kind of European education with very less fees, even in comparison to many other private universities in India, because you pay the similar amount of money in India also. In India, a number of private universities have opened up. But my university is a public university. It's a government university. And it is ranked very well throughout the world now. So our sociology program ranks in the first 50 in the world. By Shanghai ranking, it ranks in the first 50 in the world. So this is really, you know, my department, my alma mater, NUS, its sociology programs rank 6. So 6 is a, like, you know, the ranking, right? NUS sociology ranks 6 in the world now, which is fantastic. But even HSE in Moscow ranks 48 or 49 in the whole world. And in a period of only 10 years, so 20, I would say 30 years of university, but about 20 years of the sociology department, in a period of 20 years, this is remarkable achievement, actually. And people, you know, we have more than, so there are many, very many Russian scholars working in Russian language, and there is amazing scholarship which happens in Russian language. It might not be all accessible to everybody. You might have to translate and work, but it is amazing work of scholarship. And many of these scholars, when they write in English, all their papers and books gets prizes. And, you know, the best paper there, the best paper here in ISA, the Cultural Sociological Association. So you can know that the quality of work that is being produced. I mean, we all know about the great history of Russian scholarship in philosophy, in linguistics, and Bakhtin, and many others. I mean, you know, and literature, of course, it would be there. But at the same time, the university is pushing more English work. So large, many scholars are now writing in English in the very best kind of journals, academic journals in the world. And our university is very objective about that. In general, Russia is very objective now. They have a program called 5 in 100, which is sponsored by the Russian state. So the Russian state wants that 5 universities in Russia should and must be within the best 100 in the world. So they are putting funding, scholarship, libraries, and open sources into university system. They are asking teachers to do more research. They're giving them freedom to move out of Russia, do field work within Russia, produce excellent work, produce excellent students, make relationship with other universities, MOUs, you know, go to those universities, bring faculties from those universities here, you know, make relations throughout the globe to kind of have an open dialogue in education, in culture. So I think this is one of the reasons that some universities like Moscow, Lomonosov State University, Higher School of Economics, Moscow, Tumen University in Siberia, as far as in Siberia, and Professor Nina Goncharova would speak about that. And we are eager to, you know, listen to those experiences and those talks. So these universities and University, Innopolis University in Kazan, and then, you know, there's a fantastic place. I'm forgetting the name. Professor Goncharova would say that. So it is a small bit of Russia in Europe, Kaliningrad. Yes, Kaliningrad is not in Russia. So it's a small bit of Russia within Europe. So you cannot go to that, you know, Kaliningrad following Russian land route, because there's no Russia in between. There's Europe in between. So it's a small land. You know, land-surrounded island, not water-surrounded island, but kind of land-surrounded island within Europe. And you have this, you know, University of Kaliningrad. And Immanuel Kant was born in Kaliningrad. He was, you know, so the university is called Immanuel Kant University of Kaliningrad. So this is coming up big. And you find amazing, you know, history. When you know about Russia, when you study about Russia, I can talk on and on, but I'll stop here. And when you study about Russia, you know amazing things which nobody had studied. And then I as an academics, or anybody else as an academics, gets excited to study that, you know? So for example, you will be intrigued to know that the famous, the guy who come up with the idea of panopticon, not Foucault, but I'm forgetting the name. You can search it. Jeremy Bentham, yes. So Jeremy Bentham actually spent his life in Belarus with his brother. Belarus was a part of Soviet Russia. And his whole notion of panopticon actually emerged from in Belarus, looking at a industrial organization where his brother was working. So then you get excited, of course, that, oh, so this was in Belarus. And what you see in Belarus now, probably they have some kind of connection, distant connection with that, right? So you get excited about many things and, you know, issues. Anyway, I will stop here now. I can speak, you know, as long as you want, but I'm eager to hear Professor Goncharova and others and our friends and colleagues here. Thank you so much for giving me this time.
Dhanyabad, Arnab.
My pleasure.
And dear friends, as I invite dear Nina, I'll take a few minutes to put this into Odia. So, bandhumane, apan mane bujhiparthibe, amar Arnab bhai ja kahile. Au ta bitre se su kathati kahile, je adhikangsha Russian lokomane, semane bartman shaharare rahuchanti, kintu semankara gaare gote ghoroti achi. गाँ को जाती गाँ को गला बेले गाँव में तो बुढ़ी माँ वयस्क लोक मैंने थे से आचार करके रखि तेणु गोटे रूराल अर्बन कनेक्शन से साम्प्रतिक रशियारे अच्छी आपर ये संस्कृति भितर जो गोटे मिलन चली मिलनटी गोटे लोक मान भावन आसपुर बर्तमान आउ गोटे कथा कहले जे केमती से जाते जो आठ जड़े रशियान लोक को भेटिले जे रशियान संगीत मान आर डी बर्मन स्टाइल रे गाँव तेणु ये रशिया भारत बर्षर जो सांस्कृतिक आदान प्रदान जोटा आम जो बड़ फिल्म मेकर थिले जे मेरा जूता है जापान एवं ये जो व्हाट इज द नेम ऑफ दिस फिल्म मेकर
Raj Kapoor is very famous in Russia and others, you know. Bartaman Sampratika Paristitire Jo Sikha Ketrare, Bartaman Aneko emphasis dia jauchi kemti quality. Gute Gunatmaka Sikha, ebong se kahutle je ei jo university re padhauchanti seti MA padla bel ku paisa dia jauchi kintu anya desh tulanare bahut kam. That also can be a theme during the discussion, that what is the possibility for the average Russian students to access higher education, because we hear about commodification and privatization and the whole Russian oligarchy, the kind of the closure in the political system. And it might be related also to closure in other fields, you know, this whole elitistic exclusion and inequality, growing inequality, and you know, all these things will pick up during discussion. এই ভেরি মানে সংক্ষেপরে এই মর্ম সারাংশ সহিত সো নাও আই ইনভাইট নিনা প্লিজ টু কাইন্ডলি শেয়ার ইউর থট নিনা
থ্যাংক ইউ সো মাচ আই রিয়েলি ফিল হ্যাপি টু ফিল অল অফ ইউ অ্যান্ড আই এম ব্লেসড টু বি আ পার্ট অফ দিস ওয়ান্ডারফুল ইভেন্ট অ্যান্ড আই এক্সপ্রেস মাই গ্রেটিটিউড টু মাই ওল্ড ইটারনাল এভার ইয়াং ফ্রেন্ড অনন্তা গিরি. And I am very happy to accept the wonderful vision of Russia, Arnab. Thank you so much for your positive attitude to life. You radiate this love to all people, to Russians, to Indians, to all the people. This is what I felt. And it brings a wonderful feeling of our unity. And you spoke about professor, I always smiled because I am not a professor at all. But when I was in Moscow, I was serving Moscow for 2 years, just enthusiastically. They were speaking about making me a professor. I said, no, it's not obligatory. I do it because I love it, because we create a new world, a new vision, and it's not the matter of notions and names. And when Professor Ananta Giri asked me to speak about Russia and Russian history and the present Russia, I was thinking about a wonderful comparison, and I hope you will feel it, that the history of Russia has been very complicated because of wars and many obstacles, but I am confident with all my heart. I have a wonderful experience working for a new life within us, that it has been the prehistorical period. Why? What do I mean? Prehistorical means it hasn't been a true human history. When people are in conflicts or they have to even experience wars and even to kill each other sometimes, it is not human at all. So now I feel that we are here on this wonderful small one planet to make this legendary transition from the prehistorical period of the entire humanity, not only Russia, to a new one, when we have one and the same path, the one of love. I visited India twice. I lived for 10 and 15 days. I really felt that it was my homeland too, because the people, we are really one. It doesn't matter what kind of color, of skin color we have, or even language. But smiles and this attitude to life, this is what matters, how we can accept each other. And I'm really happy that during my life, I had this transition. Now I live above the line. This is my notion. What does that mean, to live above the line? There is a line inside us, within us. When we can suffer, when we can think not good things about somebody, but when we step over this line within ourselves, then we can become love. We can bring the dream of all humans to reality, because all humans dream about love, and they are love. Everybody is love. It is our soul, it is our divine gift. And when we speak about, I listen to you attentively, and I appreciate your vision about the diversity of religions, but we have one religion in my women's vision, that is the one of love. Love is the religion of the future, because we cannot be humans without higher, without divinity. And that's why love is that very bridge that can put all people together and awaken our souls. And I am very happy that one day I met a person, a great planetary educator, Talgat Akbashov, and I quitted all my jobs. I am a free bird for 30 years without any salary, any name, but my new free flight life started. I traveled all over Russia, all over 25 cities and places of Russia, 4, 5, 8, and 10 times, more than 100 trips all over Russia, for putting people out, inviting people to come out of their flats, to be together, to collaborate, to awaken who we really are, to create joint projects, just a little bit, joint dreams to be manifested. This is what we have been doing, we had been doing for 10 years. And then I started my world trip. I visited many, many world events. I'm happy to speak a little bit English because I am totally Russian. But I had this wonderful opportunity to share the collective experience that we really have, how we can awaken who we are, who we truly are, when we are together and we live together for several days in different parts of the world. And we accept each other, and we accept, like children, we accept some rules. For example, we never say no. Only everybody is accepted, everybody is right, everybody is precious, everybody is a gift for our communication, for our co-creation. And that's why I was happy to present the collective experience in many congresses in scientific and cultural, but all of them belong to new time paradigm. This is what I'm happy to belong to. And we met in Astana with Ananta, Giri, he knows. It was conducted by the president, but I was very happy to feel that this existing system is going to live, to be transformed. I was joking, I said, are they going to be transformed too? Because you know that what system is, and still we have to love all of them, because there are humans living inside. The only thing that they are not aware, many of them are not aware that they can be manipulated, because they trust, they believe that they do good, right things, and we are to express love to them. We worked with many, many governments in Russia. I was 3 times in the UN. And when I was in the UN speaking about this new paradigm and new collective model of life, we do not fight with anybody. We create a new model of life, just alternative reality, so that the brave people could step out of an old paradigm into a new one. For this, we should have this model. And this is what we have been doing, at least with me, for 30 years. And I'm really happy to tell you, and Ananta experienced it, that during this pantomime, as I joke when I speak about this, you understand what I mean with masks. It is a wonderful opportunity for people to wake up, to go inside, and to put a simple question. Who am I? Am I going to live this way? or should I realize something very important? How should we live? What kind of society we should have? And so, starting with 2009, I visited for 25 times an incredible educational and love community existing in Siberia, believe me. And if you will watch the recording of this living event that we had on 5th of June, it is in Russian, but you will feel without words. You are right, Arnav. We do not need even words when you will see how people live in the nature, in harmony with each other, how they appreciate the nature and the relationships and heaven and earth. This, for me, I am sure, I am confident that this is the seed of a new civilization for entire humanity. And there are people from all over the world living there. Almost, they all speak Russian and they are happy to speak Russian. I don't know why, but so maybe because historically it is, it happened this very way that it happens in the depth of Russia, in Siberia. You're welcome to come also. you are right. You should better to experience, to feel one once with your own heart. Then that's why you were speaking so enthusiastically, because you visited, you experienced, even in the framework of this system. The system is also good, because when people, my son is he is fond of history, he's a historical man, young man. He said, mother, if we will not have those governments, people are still wild. Some of them are wild. The behavior will be just, I said, yes, you're right, but the future is of conscious, awakened, happy, creative people, then they will not need those things that will stimulate them or even manipulate them. Because when we speak about some love only to your own country, and we are to love the entire humanity, we are all one, we are all totally one. So my life is devoted to creating this new reality, and I know that only love is this very language, this very bridge. And I have just had the vision, and before we started this wonderful event, I created a very, very small informational letter. I would love to invite you on the day out of time. If you heard about this day, it is 25th July, when I met Jose Arguelles. It's a planetary, wonderful phase. Now he passed away, but we are still telepathically connected, we are eternal. And he gave me this idea to create this event on the 25th of July, on the day out of time, this very summer. Because you know that this summer is of huge importance for entire humanity. We are in the middle of this transition. And when we will be able to create the critical mass of awakened and loving people, so it will be like this effect of 100 monkeys, you know, this effect. When people, I had several separate experience of entering this new vibrational field. It's a wonderful feeling of new, totally new kind of energy. And so we will really do it on this day out of time, also this very summer, 25th of July. I would love to show you one of my paintings and this very, very short invitation, because I feel your soul, we are one. if you allow me to demand to.
Yes, yes, you can see.
I can demonstrate, okay, well, yes. Let me see. Where is it? Invitation, our invitation. Ah, here it is, okay. It's a very, very simple. It's very simple. You see one of my paintings. It is about this new world, because the mother of the world and the divine mother, she is here. We are to create this veil of divine mother all over the planet. And day out of time, where is it? How should I switch on? Just maybe let it be this way. Day out of time, planet of love through arts. Why through arts? Because we are all divine, we are created in the image of God. We are all creators. And arts is the language of
Subhujive.
So I invite you to join us.
Hello. Bandhumana apnu mute kar diyantu, only Nina would speak. Dear Randhir, you can mute everybody except me and Nina.
Yes. Okay, sir. Go ahead.
Nina, kindly go on.
Yeah. Oh, thank you so much. So I have written only several short things to feel the breath of our unity growing and of this love. Prehistory, true human history. We should enter this very true human history when we are really create this life we would love to live in. Stepping out from the circle into ascending spiral. This is the meaning of this day out of time. When we will follow the natural calendar on planet Earth, like some indigenous people, like Altai people, maybe in your country too. And so we will not go follow one and the same circle every year, every time, season. But just on this day out of time, we can uplift each other. We can step into another level of vibration. And we will follow this very constantly one path of love, because love is the essence of every human being. It doesn't matter what nationality, what religion or ethical attachment we have. And we will create this very simple vision. We have one Mother Earth. We have one home, Mother Earth. So we are one. We are one humanity. We have one Earth. And if we follow one time, then we will simply be in resonance with the nature, with the cosmos, with the universe, with the divine. This will be one of the essence of this coming event. And we will unite creative streams of people and all time. This I hope we will be capable to do, because we have a planetary team of the transition. And Ananta Giri is one of my beloved friends. We are one team. And there are people from all over the world with the same vision that we are one. And with everybody, we do some useful things for giving birth to a new world. And of course, art is the language of love. You're welcome. I really loved the introduction of this happy meeting today. It was very beautiful. And I was moved by the fact that the song was in Russian and there was the translation into Hindi. Thank you so much. And I felt that, you know better than me, maybe, that art is the huge creative tool for expressing positive vision, positive. And this is a new vision, not taken from the suffering world. That's why. It could be some positive visions expressed by means of art. And of course, we will manifest a model of new time, new life. We have it already in Siberia. And for 30 years, they have been creating it. For 30 years, several thousands of people left their comfortable cities. They were, and they started to ennoble wild forests, wild places where there were lots of mosquitoes. Now there are no mosquitoes, because when we radiate love and light and all the good things, the nature will flourish. This I know for sure. And we will manifest harmony of male and female, such a nice thing that we appreciate each other, men and women together. And of course, there is a unity of Lord, divine in nature, heaven and earth. And imagine all waters, all kinds of plants and trees, they seem to be different. I underline this word, they seem to be different, but they have the same essence. For example, water that is taken by root, they all are focused to heaven, to the sun. And the same with spiritual development of human beings. We are all one and we have the same laws of development because we can follow this one path of love. It's very, very simple. And how we can participate, all of us, you are welcome. I will be happy to greet you there. You can present a 5-minute art video by manifesting the above visions in connection, if you resonate with it. And our hearts, I know we are so one. And send to my email address and we will include these videos and maybe your live participation into this event. And of course, I know today while I was greeting my friends, they will come soon. They arrived specially to visit Baikal. You know that Baikal is the most deep lake on planet Earth with pure water. And I happened to move to Baikal. So tomorrow we go to Baikal and so they will come. And I feel now that we really can invent this event in Baikal. Baikal accepts 336 rivers. They go into Baikal and only one river goes out, Angara. Now my friends are now on the shore of Angara. So while those streams are together, they totally change their quality. You see, because they were the streams and now they are Lake Baikal. Like this is our destiny of humanity. When we will bring the streams together, we will obtain totally different quality. We will become one creative, loving, spreading love, humanity, human family, one human family. And I would love simply to, if you will have any questions, I would love to answer them, any questions, because this is the best way to communicate.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Спасибо. I would be happy. Спасибо. Пожалуйста. Я вас люблю. I love you, all of you. You are so nice. I feel your radiant eyes, your interest expressed. Not even a simple interest, but your soul radiating from your eyes. I'm ready to answer questions if you have any.
We are coming to you. Now, in the meantime, I just want to check with Randhir. Hello, Randhir. Seems you are expected in the other conference immediately.
Yes, yes. Yes, we can sum up within 10 minutes. We have 10 minutes.
What I would request is that maybe it might go to 10 to 15 minutes, and I wanted to make sure that you are not feeling too kind of pressurized. And it is in that spirit. So in case you have to leave after 10 minutes, you can kindly do, and I would carry forward the dialogue for a little bit. Is it okay?
Actually, we have to start the session from this Zoom.
Okay. So then we will take 10 minutes. Are you comfortable?
Yes. Okay. No problem.
So, dear friends, it has been very enriching listening to Arnab and Nina. And then I would request now, many friends are present, and if necessary, we'll continue the conversation next time also. And today is a little bit of this kiss of time, let us put it this way. Now, we have many dear friends with us, and we are very grateful that from the other part of our dear mother planet, we have Professor Silvio Suarez da Silva, and he's a very kind man, and anthropologist, and a very deep soul, and he lives in Recife in Brazil, and I was very blessed to meet him and his family in 2018. So let us listen to Professor Silvio for a few minutes. Professor Silvio, you can kindly unmute and share with us your reflections for 2 minutes, please. Okay, Professor Silvio is taking a bit of time. Now, in the spirit of this journey with Russia, I had requested Sushri Appa to present a poem of Boris Pasternak, the great Russian writer. So, Sushri Appa, please.
Good evening, a very good evening to all. Bhai, am I audible?
Yes, you're audible.
Hi, good evening to you, Randhir, and good evening.
We cannot see you. Nina, would
now
like.
Is it okay?
Yes, okay.
Yes. Okay, and so without a word exchange, thank you so much. Loved it, absolutely. We have to connect up later. I have to rush into. I have selected this poem by Boris Pasternak. The title of the poem is After the Storm. And I'm sure that many of us would have already come out as one of the most, masterpiece that is. The air is full of, I thought this poem would be very, give me a second to get the poem on the screen. Here goes. The air is full of after thunder freshness, and everything rejoices and revives with the whole outburst of the purple skulls cluster. The lilac drinks, with the whole outburst of the purple's cluster, the lilac drinks the air of paradise. The gutters overflow the change of weather. The gutters overflow the change of weather, makes all you see appear alive and new. Meanwhile, the shades of the sky are growing lighter. Meanwhile, the shades of the sky are growing lighter. Beyond the blackest cloud, the height is blue. I thought this is probably the essence of the poem. I'll just complete it, few more lines there. An artist's hand with mystery still greater wipes the dirt and dust of objects in his path. Reality and life, the past, the present, emerge transformed out of his colored bath. The memory of over half a lifetime, like swiftly passing thunder, dies away. The century is no more under WhatsApp. High time to let the future have its say. It is not the revolution, not upheaval, that clear the roads to the new and better days, but revelation and lavishness and torments of someone's soul, inspired and ablaze. Bhai, I'll take just one more minute to try and translate this into Odia. I was doing it as I was, reading. And I think it, here goes, Jhada Pare. And I'm, okay. Ghada ghadi bijuli o bajrapata pare, ebe sabu paripurna taja pabanare. Ghada ghadi bijuli o bajrapata pare, ebe sabu paripurna taja pabanare, sabu kichi anandita punarjivita, pijauchi naisargika pabana lailak phulabasi, phati paduthuba baigani guchha bhitare. Nalaru uchhudi pade pani pagara parivartana, sethire sabu dise jibanta o nutana, tene dhusara akasa chaya halka halka ujola, kala meghara bahare uchcha akasa je nila. How profound. Kala meghara bahare uchcha akasa je nila. Beyond the darkness of the sky, beyond the darkness of the cloud, the sky is always blue. Sabu rahasya tu badi, ସବୁ ରହସ୍ୟ ଠୁ ବଡ଼ କେଉଁ କଳାକାରର ସେ ହାତ ପୋଛି ଦିଏ ଧୂଳି ମଳି ଯେତେ ତା ରାସ୍ତାରୁ ବାସ୍ତବତା ଓ ଜୀବନ ଅତୀତ ଓ ବର୍ତ୍ତମାନ ସବୁକିଛି ରୂପାନ୍ତରିତ ହୋଇ ଉଠି ଆସନ୍ତି ରଙ୍ଗ ସ୍ନାନରୁ ଅଧାରୁ ଅଧିକ ଜୀବନର ସ୍ମୃତି ପୋଛି ହୋଇଯାଏ ହଠାତ୍ ଆସି ଫେରି ଯାଉଥିବା ଘଡ଼ଘଡ଼ି ପରି ଶତାବ୍ଦୀ ଓ ସାମ୍ରାଜ୍ୟର ଶତାବ୍ଦୀ ଆଉ ସାମ୍ରାଜ୍ୟର ଅଧୀନରେ ନାହିଁ ଦିସ୍ ଇଜ୍ ଅନଦର ଲାଇନ୍ ଶତାବ୍ଦୀ ଆଉ ସାମ୍ରାଜ୍ୟର ଅଧୀନରେ ନାହିଁ ସେଞ୍ଚୁରି ଇଜ୍ ନୋ ଲଙ୍ଗର୍ ଇନ୍ ଦ ଅଣ୍ଡର ଦ ୱାର୍ଡସିପ୍ ଶତାବ୍ଦୀ ଆଉ ସାମ୍ରାଜ୍ୟର ଅଧୀନରେ ନାହିଁ ଏବେ ସମୟ ଆସିଛି ଭବିଷ୍ୟତକୁ ତା ବାଟ ଛାଡ଼ିଦେବା ପାଇଁ ଯାହା ନୂତନ ଉଜ୍ଜଳ ଦିନକୁ ରାସ୍ତା ଦିଏ ତା ତ ଯାହା ନୂତନ ଉଜ୍ଜଳ ଦିନକୁ ରାସ୍ତା ବନାଏ ତା ବିପ୍ଳବ ବିଦ୍ରୋହ କି ଉତ୍ତେଜନା ନୁହେଁ ତାହା ଆସେ କାହା କାହା ଆତ୍ମାରୁ ନିଃସୃତ ଆଲୋକ ଅବା ଯନ୍ତ୍ରଣା ଦେଇ ଯାହା ରହେ ଜୀବନ୍ତ ଜ୍ୱଳନ୍ତ
ଧନ୍ୟବାଦ ସୁଶ୍ରୀ ଅପା ଇଟ୍ ଇଜ୍ ସୋ ଲଭଲି ଆଣ୍ଡ ଡିଅର୍ ଫ୍ରେଣ୍ଡସ୍ ଟୁଡେ ଏଗେନ୍ ୱି ଆର୍ ଏମ୍ବ୍ରେସ୍ଡ ବାଇ ଦି ଲଭ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଟାଇମ୍ ବଟ୍ ୱିଥ୍ ଆୱାର୍ ମ୍ୟୁଚୁଆଲ୍ ଜେନରୋସିଟି ଆଣ୍ଡ ଆୱାର୍ ଡିଅର୍ ଫ୍ରେଣ୍ଡ ହୋଷ୍ଟ ରଣଧୀର ଇଜ୍ ଅଲ୍ସୋ ହୋଷ୍ଟିଂ ଆନଦର ଭେରି ଡିପ୍ଲି ଇନ୍ଭାଇଟିଂ ଅକେଜନ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଆଇ ଇନ୍ଭାଇଟ୍ ରଣଧୀର ଟୁ କାଇଣ୍ଡଲି ସେଣ୍ଡ ଦି Zoom link to chat also. Friends can join in if possible. So as Randhir has to go, so maybe we would, you know, we would keep our conversation at this point and then we'll meet again. We'll have another moment. We'll nurture another meeting together. We have planted many beautiful seeds today. Of our soul, of our eagerness to learn with each other, Arnab and Nina, Susriyapa's poem into Odia. So, Randhir, it is getting time for you to leave, no? It is almost
Yes. And I'm sharing the details of in the chat box itself, so you can join World Poetry Conference also.
And so you can email it to me.
So I will email you also.
With this, so slowly we will come to Iowa. And then we will meet again. We'll make another meeting in July with mutual availability of Nina and Arnav. And we'll also learn a little bit more about Russia. So thank you all dear friends for participating. And now I would leave, before I leave the last word to Arnav, to Randhir, maybe we'll just hear from Arnab and Nina for half a minute. Arnab?
Thank you so much, Professor Giri, and you know, Randhir and Nina and everybody else, and Shushri, who has, you know, rendered such a beautiful poetry of Pasternak. So I'm, you know, extremely happy to share my experiences with you, and in future, I will, you know, happily talk and share these experiences, and I enjoyed this session with my soul and spirit today. Thank you so much.
And Nina?
I also express my unlimited gratitude to this wonderful opportunity to really feel all of you as me, as myself, because we are totally one. This I feel very greatly. And all my poems, they are in fact in Russian, but I can say spontaneously several words, translate this poem when we created a big event in Moscow for the women of the world, for women. Russia, golden doors, it is time for you to awaken, and for women that happen to go through all kinds of obstacles, to be transformed into the wonderful beauty of fairy tale women. And the sleeping goddess that is inside will spread her wonderful wings, and we will look with the eyes of our hearts that it is we who can create this fairy tale. It's just, this is the meaning of one of them, the beginning of one of the poems in Russian about the mission of Russia, because I am happy to be a part of Russia, though I know that Russia is a part of the world and that we are one. So thank you so much. And I hope that we will not part. I will be out of the cities all summer long, but still on the 25th, I hope that some of you, together with Ananta, can join us in this happy event. Let us be feel each other as one. Thank you.
And dear friends, this concluding line of Nina, fairy tale,
yes,
is also a fair tale, F-A-I-R. and our sisters present, they know about fair and lovely. So that fair tale, and that is the invitation of us. And Pasternak's poem, the out of the cloud, we move towards the land of fairness. And it is with that spirit and Randhir. So
Ananta, why now that is not fair and lovely? It has been, that is now glow and lovely.
So,
and it
so
has Miniti been
Pradhan, Miniti Pradhan, if you have any poem, you can present.
Thank you for the...
You
okay, I can read one earth poem. I can read one earth poem.
Yes, yes, please.
Yeah. Okay, thank you everyone for this and good evening. So this is a poem I had written on the Earth Day. So this is, goes like this. Earth, the bearer of all living beings, the provider, nurturer of every cell in us. Earth, the bearer of all living beings, the provider, nurturer of every cell in us. Earth, the donor, the beautiful azure sky, meadows, the vast blue oceans, the waves, clouds, and joy. Earth, the sufferer, being rendered barren, raped and maimed. Can you listen to her pain? Earth, the survivor is not dead yet, even though choked, unable to breathe by our thoughtless action. Earth, the mother, whatever she gave, we must share, discarding greed, reduce, reuse, and recycle. Make every day Earth Day to show that you care. Thank you.
Thank you. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Thank you so much for giving me the opportunity to read this.
Yes. So with these words, now I would like to conclude this session. And Dr. Devendra Kumar Tiwari, if you can give a formal vote of thanks within 2 minutes.
Thank you very much for Randhir sir for giving me this opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible. We have 2 minutes,
sir. Yes. Okay, so really, it was a nice talk by Dr. Arnab Roy Chowdhury, and everybody who was part of this discussion came to know much more about Russia and his experience with Russia. So formally, I would like to say thanks to everybody. It's an honor for me to extend my vote of thanks. Dr. Arnab Roy Chowdhury, the postdoc fellow at one of the universities in Russia. Sir, we are grateful on behalf of Raffles University, RAISE Global Foundation, and Vishwaneedam Sahachkara. I feel privileged to extend a very warm vote of thanks to you, sir. It is my honor and privilege to extend a vote of thanks to Honorable Revered Dr. Meena V. Gomber, the former judge of Rajasthan High Court, Honorable Dr. Divakar Goli, the Vice Chancellor of Raffles University, and all the eminent participants dignitaries who graced the importance of today's talk with their benign presence and their wonderful insights. I express my deep and heartfelt gratitude and vote of thanks to each one of you. As I have limitation of time, so I would like to wind up it here. And from the core of my heart, I wish you all a very happy time. It has been a nice discussion, and definitely we'll meet again. I welcome you all in future.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Arnab Roy Chowdhury, sir. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, Neem. Thank you.
Thank you, friends. We'll meet again.
Namaste. Thank you.